Perfect. Hi, my name is Martin. This is Zora. But enough about me. Let's talk about encapsulation. The reason I wanted to give this talk, this book about functional programming in Scala, it's called Functional Programming in Scala. The authors are Paul Cesano and Runar Bjarnason. They're rather well known in the Scala community, and it's a fantastic book. It's great introductory material. It covers a lot of ground. I recommend it highly. Among other things, it contains this sidebar, which is maybe the most controversial thing about the book, except maybe the fact that they're using Scala. But nevertheless, I'm going to read it to you. One might object that algebraic data types violate encapsulation by making public the internal representation of a type. Exposing the data constructors of a type is often fine, and the decision to do so is approached much like any other decision about what the public API of a data type should be. The emphasis is mine, of course. Again, I think this is well argued in the book. I think it makes a lot of sense. And one of the authors, Paul, a few years back tweeted that this is still one of his favorite sidebars from the book. But you remember the other author, Runar, a few years even before the book, he wrote a paper called Stackless Scala with Free Monads. And in that paper, he writes an implementation of free monads in Scala. But in doing that, he discovers a problem. The problem in that case is that the flat map operation on free monads cannot be implemented in a tail recursive way. And that means it's not stack safe. So for free monads that are structured in a particular way, maybe nested a few levels deep, if you call flat map on them, your JVM stack is going to blow up at runtime, even though your code should be correct by itself. To work around that problem, he writes this. So what's happening here is this introduces a data constructor called flat map, which has the exact same type signature as the flat map operation. But it's nested as a hidden data constructor inside the free trait. The way he's using it is whenever you're calling the flat map operation, instead of trying to calculate the result, he's lifting it up into the type and constructing this thing on the heap instead of on the stack. And by doing that, this operation becomes stack safe because it doesn't use the stack, it uses the heap. But let's talk a bit more about what's happening here. There seems to be some kind of tension between the mathematical structure that we're trying to work with and the reality of actually running code on our machine. We've tried to write a faithful implementation of the structure, but after we've done that, our code that should be correct is blowing up at runtime. So, I forgot to do this. So again, there's obviously some kind of tension here. I'm going to go back a slide. There's obviously some kind of tension here. The solution in this case was to prevent the runtime system from bleeding into our implementation. In this case was to encapsulate data, which we were told was going to be fine if we didn't do it. Which begs the question, when is exposing our data constructors not fine? There's obviously some circumstances under which we're supposed to encapsulate, under which it makes sense to encapsulate our constructors. Otherwise, we wouldn't ever have to do it. And I believe a related question is the question of pattern matching. I think there's been more discussion about that in the Scala community than maybe in other functional languages. There used to be some people that advocated for not using pattern matching at all and just accessing the structure of your types by using folds. The arguments are usually in the same vein as the ones for using accessors instead of raw field access or factory methods instead of calling raw constructors. Because by doing that, you give yourself, as the creator of the type, you give yourself a place to define the behavior, to customize the behavior that otherwise would be automatically generated from your type description. So on the one hand, we have people who advocate working with ADTs, with public structure, public data constructors, that we process by using pattern matching on them, where we have access to the structure of the types. And on the other hand, there are people advocating for opaque data types, where we do not have any access to the structure, where we just have a set interface that contains everything that we have access to, and where we process the data by accessing just that interface. Let's try to look at an example. Imagine you've written some kind of service, maybe some kind of backend for a hugely popular web application. Somewhere in that service, you've defined this type. It represents a sequence of elements. You're calling it list. And it's made up by nils and consists. And you've discovered all of these great operations that it supports, like a fold and map and flat map. I've omitted those here. And you've also noticed that this type is a monoid. You have an append operation on there. So you start using it everywhere. Everywhere you're using writer monads to do log aggregation, for example. But you also notice that that approach doesn't scale well because the append operation is linear in the length of the list you're appending to. Right? So again, I'm trying to create a kind of similar situation here, where there's some kind of tension between the mathematical objects that we're trying to work with and the reality, this time of runtime complexity instead of correctness. So let's try to use a similar approach to solve this. Why not just introduce another case to our list class? Let's call it append. Other people might call it conk lists. You may have heard of those. It contains two lists, a left list and a right list. And when we're calling the append operation, we just return that, and we can prune nils of either end because we know the monoid laws. The greatest thing about this, though, the fold operation retains the exact same interface. We can still pretend that this kind of list, with this new separate case, has the same structure, the same interface as our list did before. Does anyone here think that's a good idea? Thank you, Lars. Okay. Of course, I think it's not, but I'm going to tell you about why. There are some problems that this introduces into your code base. The first and most obvious one, of course, this breaks pattern matching. This is possibly a more severe problem in Scala because by default, if your Scala pattern matches are not exhaustive, that just emits a compiler warning and not an error. You need additional compiler flags to turn those warnings into errors. And otherwise, the code's going to blow up at runtime because you didn't check your compiler output valiantly. But of course, we introduced a new case, so of course, pattern matching breaks. That was to be expected, right? Another thing this violates is the no confusion guideline. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of it, so let's talk about that a bit more. No junk, no confusion is a slogan by Joe Gogan, whose work I encourage you to check out. It's a set of guidelines for the use of, for the representation, for the encoding of mathematical structures in computer science and program code. Because we're not working directly with mathematical objects here, we're working with encodings of those structures in our code. In that context, junk means if we have an instance of our type that does not correspond to something inside that mathematical structure, we can have some way to construct illegal values of our type. That is junk, and that's obviously a problem because if we can construct illegal values, then those are going to be illegal and not, and we won't be able to process them sensibly in some contexts. So this is essentially inviting our type system to lie to us, and I don't think anybody wants that. But we're not in violation of that, so far so good. No confusion means, you can probably read the diagrams as well. I'm going to explain it anyway. So if you have two separate ways to construct instances of your type, using different constructors in a way such that both represent the same value of your mathematical structure, you're going to run into trouble. So take a list of two elements. You can split it in the middle, put it back together using append. And instead of just consts and nils, you've got cons, nil, and append, and cons, nil. That's still the same sequence of just those two elements. The problems that this creates is this turns a lot of structural problems into semantic problems, like an equality check of a list. Before this change, we could do a purely structural recursion on the list and just on every level say if both lists share the same structure and the same values inside the structure, they're of course both equivalent. We can't do that anymore now. We need to come up with some kind of canonical representation of a list and convert both to that representation before we can even start trying to compare them. The old equality method we could even have generated automatically. This one we can't, because we can't tell the compiler about what the semantics of this type are supposed to be. This canonical form, if we're trying to create that while we do the equality checking, we're also introducing allocation into our equality checks, which is usually not something you're going to expect. You might try to get around that by trying to get to the canonical form early, try to do that eagerly. But if the canonical form of the append list is just consts and nils, then you've basically reverted back to the old append method, which is exactly what that does. The root of all the problems that you're going to have here, and some other problems, is that we've changed the algebra of a type. We've changed the structure, and by that we've changed the algebra, and by that we've changed the nature of the type we're working with. So essentially we're now working with a completely different type. We shouldn't expect any of the code we wrote that works on it to still work the same. This is the reason pattern matching breaks. But this is also the reason why certain other operations suddenly start behaving differently. The only thing that we've kept stable in doing this evolution is we've kept the interface of fold the same. So the only real assumption we can make about this new type that carries over is that fold still behaves the same, which means we need to assume that every operation has to be implemented in terms of fold, like taking the head of a list. Taking the head of this kind of list suddenly turns into a linear operation. And who's going to expect that? Because you need to walk through the appends down the tree. Right, I'm going fast today. Here's some recommendations I can give you about how I'd recommend you deal with this kind of situation. You've probably heard this thing. It's called Postel's Law or the Robustness Principle. It originates from one of the TCP specifications, but I think it's applicable in a lot more contexts. For example, functional programming. We're writing functions, trying to be liberal in what we accept from others. In the case of functions, I think means that we should try for our input types to use the most general types at all possible for us to use. With good type inference, that's exactly what the compiler is going to infer for us. If we have to write our types down explicitly, then that's still what we should write down for our functions. Because in describing our input types, we are describing the assumptions we are making about our inputs. And we should be explicit about what our assumptions are. By using the most general types possible, we're declaring fewer assumptions on those types. And we are not declaring assumptions that we aren't actually required to make. So somebody calling our function is going to have an easier time providing us with the data. Being conservative in what you do, on the other hand, that concerns our output types. I think in your output types of functions, you should try to be as specific as you can get away with. some cases in which that doesn't make sense. For example, in Swift, if you have an array and you call reverse and then map on that list, or if you call map and then reverse on that same list, those two sequences of operations return completely different types. I think that would be an instance where we would over-constrain ourselves to a certain order of operations that should be identical. I mean, map and reverse should be able to switch places, right? But when we don't do that, again, this communicates explicitly what kinds of assumptions somebody can make about the types we're returning. If everybody else adheres to this principle as well, they're going to be fine with our specific types if we return them. If they didn't adhere to the principle, or if they actually made some assumptions that need to hold true of our return types, then if we don't fulfill those assumptions, the code should break. That's what the compiler is for. That's why I think explicit return types, specific return types, make a lot of sense. Now imagine you're writing a library. I believe that most libraries for programming you write have one primary purpose, and that's either providing a language or interpreting a language. Language, in this case, means like it's described in the interpreter pattern, some kind of structure of symbols that somebody else can interpret. Most libraries either provide us with some kind of structure that we can then operate on, like standard libraries. They provide us maps and lists and sets and other types that we can work with. Other libraries use languages, they use structures, and operate on them to do stuff for us, like a JSON converter library. You need to feed it those JSON parser type class instances for it to work. Or test generation libraries like QuickCheck. You need test generation strategies for your types for those to work. You feed those to it, and they consume the language that you're providing for them there. They've defined the language, but you're providing instances of that language to them. If you're providing a language, you should really try to expose the structure of the language you're providing, because that's essentially what a language is, right? I've just said a language as interpreted as a structure of symbols. If you're providing types to someone else that someone else should operate on, you won't regret providing them with a structure. You're giving them more flexibility. If you want to change something about your structure, I'm going to talk about that later. On the other hand, if you're interpreting a language, you should try consuming interfaces. Again, these are really both applications of the robustness principle. If you're consuming a language, it's usually either the case that you are providing the language yourself, like you've written your test generation library, and you've also written the interface, the type class of test generation strategies. In that case, providing that strategy as an interface and just relying on that interface, consuming that interface, gives you the flexibility to adapt your internal structures, because as long as the generators that you create for your own library, as those still satisfy the interface, you're going to be fine. If you're not providing them yourself, you afford the same flexibility to whoever does. And if somebody is providing that interface that you're consuming, it also means that some third party even may provide separate implementations of those interfaces, some separate instances of your type classes that you need to be fed. If you're evolving your library and you're trying to introduce some kind of abstraction, please don't be tempted to replace an existing structure with an abstraction over that structure. Like, imagine if you have linked lists in your list type and you're trying to introduce an array next to them. You wouldn't come up with the idea of list used to be the list type, now list is the interface over both, and we've got linked lists and array lists that implement them. Instead, just keep the list, put an array next to it, and then write some separate entity, some ordered sequence type class that they can both adhere to. This is also what I think you should do if you've written a library that provides structure and you want to make internal changes to that structure. If that means you're changing the structure, just provide that as a separate structure. The people who use the library are going to be thankful. If you're not writing a library, if you're writing in a business application and you've got some business domain model that you're using, and you're making changes to that model, I think that should absolutely affect the downstream code that consumes that model. If it relies on that model and not some kind of abstraction, then that's exactly what you should do, because you've made assumptions about the structure of your business domain, and those assumptions no longer necessarily hold true, because you've changed it. Again, the same thing holds true for functions. If you're trying to change what a function does in such a way that this would that it would now provide a different return type than it used to, you can provide that as a separate function. You can have those as two distinct entities in your library. And you can use versioning to... you can declare different versions to ensure that people who don't want to upgrade to the new behavior have a stable upgrade path, that they can stay on the old behavior for as long as they need to, because they're going to have a bad time upgrading, potentially. If you arrive at a situation where you think that this leads to too tight coupling between two parts of your system, then that means that you probably should have made those two parts of the system separate. Like in domain-driven design speak, maybe they should be two different bounded contexts with an anti-corruption layer in between. That necessarily means you have a separate entity for the adaptation between the inputs and the outputs, between the one component and the other component. Finally, the best thing about pattern matching. Pattern matching can be nested. If there's one thing you take away from this talk at all, is that pattern matching can be nested. What this means is, if you've got some custom types like foo and bar, you can pattern match on a pair of an optional foo and an either something or a bar. And you can do all of that in one line. And you get to access the data inside of those types. And of course, in this instance, we've required the types. We know that these are exactly the types that we've been providing, so those are the types that we can pattern match on. Trying to do the same thing with fold is just such an unnecessary amount of gymnastics to go through. The other big benefit of pattern matching, in my mind, is that it gives us more flexibility in defining our types. Say we've defined some kind of language and we want to use free monads to turn that into some kind of program type, a language like in an expression language with constants and addition and subtraction or something. We really want to write the second line because a program of that language is the free monad of that language. If we don't allow pattern matching, we can't access the structure of that kind of program. We can't define a custom fold method on those programs because we haven't defined their own type. We've only declared them as an alias to the free monad type. And free monads probably already have some kind of catamorphism defined for them. And if they don't, why should this application of the free monad be the one that gets to define the fold for free monads? So if you wanted to enforce encapsulation and try to restrict pattern matching on all of your types, you'd have to write something like the above code, where you're, again, doing some kind of unnecessary gymnastics just to wrap the free monad in another type, just so you have a place to hang your methods. So yeah, pattern matching. I recommend it. Try to use it. Try to support it. When you're writing code for somebody else to use, try to expose the structures of your ADTs. And try to use ADTs, obviously. And yeah, that's actually it. Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm not sure exactly what you mean. What kind of language definition? Right. Language, for example, is some kind of expression language. My language is an expression type that has a constant and an addition of two things and a subtraction of two things.
I was wondering if you would take performance considerations into account when deciding whether to exhibit pattern matching or exhibit.
Absolutely. If I notice that there's a noticeable performance degradation in doing one or the other, I do think I would take that into account. The thing about performance is your runtime performance depends very heavily on the types that you're using. Like you can write some kind of binary search on a list, and when you're doing that, if you don't declare the precondition that this needs to be sorted, for example, if you don't declare that in your type, then that means you need to assume that this list is not sorted when you start. So you need to sort it before you start trying the binary search on it. If you declare a function that takes any Java collection at all, and you assume that this collection does not have any duplicates, then you need to remove the duplicates yourself by, say, turning that into a set and then turning it back into whatever collection it used to be. That, I think, is what usually leads to the performance hits you're seeing when using this kind of abstraction. And what I'm advocating for in this kinds of situations, if you have performance requirements, then you should be explicit about those performance requirements and then have a separate layer in between the code that produces the data that you're operating on and the code that's trying to be performant about the data. Something where we say, this function has this requirement, we need this exact type, so let's produce it from the data we're being fed.
Okay.
I didn't actually know that. I need to check that out. I haven't been using Haskell for a while now. I've been deeper into Scala land there. Does anyone know the answer? Okay.